there's a lot of hard problems in science, but only one of them is called the hard problem, and that's consciousness. How does the big pink squishy thing inside my noggin interpret my entire experience of life? To find that out, I have trapped a neuroscientist in an elevator, so I'm gonna go get her to explain. We better go, she's been in there a while. So one of my favorite things is that I just get to come in and ask a bunch of really difficult questions and somebody else has to answer them. And I hear that what I'm asking today is actually sometimes called the hard problem.
Yeah, it is. It's a really hard problem, this one. People have been trying to work this problem out for thousands of years.
Yeah, great. Well, you have an elevator ride to try and explain it to me.
I'll do my best.
Okay, ready?
Yep.
Set. What is consciousness?
Well, from a neurobiological perspective, consciousness is our kind of brain's awareness, being aware of our inner self, our inner world, and the world around us.
Okay, that sounds pretty simple. What makes it hard?
Well, we don't exactly know how the brain creates that experience. And it doesn't really seem to exist in any specific part of the brain. Instead, it's something to do with different regions and different networks in the brain having conversations and sending messages back and forward. One really nice analogy is to think about it as being like a theatre. So we have a stage with a spotlight and...
I'll get the next one.
Sorry.
Whatever's on the stage in the light is what's in our conscious awareness, what we're kind of noticing at that point of time. And then you've got, you know, what's in the wings and backstage and the orchestra pit, and all of that's kind of going on. So we might even have thoughts happening backstage we're not aware of.
So backstage is subconsciousness.
That's one way to think about it. But you know when you have an aha moment or
yeah.
an insight, that may be when a thought that's been backstage kind of comes into our conscious awareness.
Okay, yeah. What's unconsciousness then?
Yeah, that is a really good question. And it's really hard from a neuroscience perspective to measure that because...
Oh, we're at the top. We're halfway through. Yeah, this seems totally easy. It's fine.
We all experience being unconscious every day when we're like in deep sleep
yeah.
or when someone's had a general anesthetic, or if you're, you know, someone's in a coma. I think it's important to define consciousness and understand unconsciousness because that is going to inform end of life decision making. Is there stuff going on in their subconscious that we just can't measure?
So is it possible for us to create consciousness through like AI or anything like that?
If that fits a lot of the definitions of consciousness,
oh
then...
my gosh. God! What happened? Did
I was very conscious of that experience. That sensation.
Hmm? Hi.
Hello.
We're stuck in the elevator. It's not moving. Please come back. Like, see our faces when that happened. I think it's working again. Okay, let's try. Oh yeah, it's moving, I think. We're good.
It's not going really fast like it does.
Consciousness. Tell me, where were we?
So
what's happening in the brain when you're conscious versus unconscious? What does that actually look like?
Well, we can use fMRI or brain imaging to get a look at what neural signatures look like. Someone who's unconscious, signals are coming into the brain, but they're not moving around. They're decoupled. The conversations have sort of stopped.
So what does that mean? So there's still messages being transmitted, but then they're not going anywhere else?
The different parts of the brain aren't in communication with each other, and that's why we think it's that communication, those networks talking, that's where consciousness is somehow emerging.
Is there a difference between unconscious in, say, a medically induced coma versus sleep?
That's a really good question. If someone's in deep, deep, deep sleep, we don't see the same neural signatures that we do in someone who is anaesthetised, but someone who is anaesthetised does have a similar neural signature to someone who is perhaps in a vegetative state or a coma.
Are humans the only things that are conscious? Because I would instinctively say no,
but probably not, because we think that our neurobiology creates consciousness, but whether or not other animals, like my dog, for example, has the ability to reflect on his own thoughts. One of the problems with consciousness is we rely on people being able to explain their experience of it to us, and dogs don't have language to be able to do that.
Right, and everyone experiences stuff differently.
I guess that's why it is such a hard problem, because it comes back so much to our own personal experiences and sense of who we are.
We now have the shared experience of getting stuck in this elevator for a short time.
Yeah, with that whole drop and that sudden stop
that
and that whole life-death thing.
Scary and unexpected. Thank you so much.
All right. You open the door.
When I walked out of the lift on that one, it seemed pretty simple. And on further reflection, I think that's because humans all have a pretty innate idea of what consciousness is. We all experience it. But if you were to think about someone in a vegetative state, in a coma, that, you know, doesn't seem to have much brain activity, you would not necessarily feel a whole lot of moral qualms about giving them a quiet end to life. You would often, I guess, think of it as being quite kind. But is that right if we can't measure it? If we can't measure if someone's conscious, we just know that they're unresponsive and they don't have a lot of brain activity and we choose to end their life. Is that the right thing to do? Could they still be conscious and we just don't know it? So I think consciousness is a really big, tricky one, a lot trickier than I thought it was when we started. And I think we're gonna need a taller building for this one. If you want to see more videos from us, then hit the subscribe button and you'll get an alert when we post something new, and you can expect something about next week.